The greatest gift. What's under the tree? Oh my, look at those two big ones on either side of the tree. And one of them has your name on it, and one of them has my name on it. Whoa, dude. I bet they're both some assembly required. And look at that tiny one tied to the lower branch of the tree with mom's name on it. You know what they say, the best gifts always come in little packages. Ooh, this one looks like Rover's getting another giant bone this year. We know what this one is. It's the usual necktie for Dad. Hey, I wonder why we never see those again after he opens them. You won't find the greatest gift under the tree. Under the Christmas tree, that is. Hosea chapter 14, verse 8, God states, I am like a green fir tree. And you know what? That's the tree that lies the greatest gift at his feet. The greatest gift lies at the feet of that tree. Prophecy of the greatest gift can be found throughout the Old Testament. And we're going to go to Isaiah chapter 7, verse 1. Please open your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 7, verse 1. We ask that word of Yeshua in Jesus' precious name. Father, we ask you to open eyes, open ears this day as we seek that word of wisdom. Chapter 7, verse 1, the book of Isaiah, and it reads, And it came to pass in the days of Ahaz, the son of Jotham, the son of Uzziah, king of Judah, that Rezin, the king of Syria, and Pekah, the son of Remaliah, king of Israel, went up toward Jerusalem to war against it, but could not prevail against it. Why? Because it was God's will that they not prevail against Israel. But this is trouble for Judah. You've got the Syrians had defeated the Edomites. And now they've joined forces with the 10 northern tribes, and they're coming against Jerusalem. Ahaz, by the way, not one of the better kings of Judah. Quite the contrary. Now, he had a son named Hezekiah, who was a very righteous king, did a lot of good things for Judah. Ahaz, on the other hand, they closed the temple down during his reign. First thing Hezekiah did was open the temple doors. Verse 2. And it was told the house of David, meaning Judah, saying Syria is confederate with Ephraim. They're allies. And his heart was moved. In other words, they shook. And the heart of his people, of Judah, as the trees of the wood are moved with the wind. They were trembling. Like I said, Rezin took Elath from the Edomites. Now he's joined with forces with Pekah. Verse 5. Or 4:3, I should say. Then said the Lord unto Isaiah, Go forth now to meet Ahaz, thou and Sher-Ab-Jashub, thy son, at the end of the conduit of the upper pool in the highway of the fuller's fields. Verse 4. And say unto him, this is addressed to Ahaz, Take heed and be quiet. Fear not. Neither be faint-hearted, for the two tails of the smoking firebrands, for the fierce anger of Rezin with Syria, and the son of Remaliah, which is Pekah. That's the two smoking firebrands that he's talking about. Rezin, the king of Syria, Pekah, the king of Israel. Verse 5, Because Syria, Ephraim, and the son of Remaliah have taken evil counsel against thee, saying, Let us go up against Judah and vex it, and let us make a breach, a hole therein for us, and set a king in the midst of it, even the son of Tabeel. There's only one problem with their plan. This wasn't God's plan. But they're planning on doing away with Ahaz and appointing their own vassal king. Verse 7. Thus saith the Lord God, it shall not stand, neither shall it come to pass. But God wanted Ahaz to trust in him, not Asher. You know, that was the problem with most of the kings of Israel and Judah. Every time trouble came their way, rather than trusting in God, they'd go trying to hire the Egyptians or someone to fight for them instead of trusting in God. Verse 8, for the head of Syria is Damascus, that's the capital of Syria. And the head of Damascus is Rezin, he's the king. And within 75 years, that's 65 years, shall Ephraim be broken that it be not a people. The 10 tribes would go into captivity. And the head of Ephraim is Samaria, the capital, the 10 northern tribes. And the head of Samaria is Remaliah's son. Notice God doesn't even say Pekah through the prophet of Isaiah, Remaliah's son. If you will not believe, surely ye shall not be established. The 10 tribes were going down. They didn't believe. Verse 10. Moreover, the Lord spake again unto Ahaz, saying, ask thee a sign of the Lord thy God. Ask it either in the depth or in the height above. Make your inquiry deep, is what he's saying. I don't care if it's in heaven or below the earth in hell. Just ask your sign. But Ahaz said, I will not ask, neither will I tempt the Lord. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 16. We learn that tempting the Lord is a very, very serious matter. But the Lord said, ask for a sign. So that wouldn't be tempting him. You say they would not believe without seeing, and when signs were offered them to see, in order that they might believe, they would not even look. 13, and he said, hear ye now, O house of David, house of Judah. Is it a small thing for you to weary men, meaning Isaiah, but will ye weary my God also? Verse 14, the reason we came here, the sign that Isaiah would, that the Lord would give them through Isaiah. Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel. Emmanuel, if you translate it, you know, God with us. Kings and men awaited for the coming of this promised Messiah. When it was time, his birth was announced by the archangel Gabriel. Turn with me to Luke chapter 1. In the Gospels, Luke chapter 1, let's pick it up with verse 5. There was in the days of Herod, the king of Judea, a certain priest named Zacharias, of the course of Abiah, and his wife was of the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. Now, for those of you who don't know, there were 24 courses of the priests that were established. The course of Abiah, which is what Zacharias will be serving under, was the 8th of the 24 courses. Now, the priest might be located outside of Jerusalem, but they were called in to Jerusalem during their course to serve in the temple. And this was from Sabbath to Sabbath, 1 week, and then they would rotate through the 24 and then start over through the first one, through 24 again. And of course, then when they had the three major ingatherings, Passover, the Feast of Weeks, and also the Feast of Tabernacles, all the priests came in and served. And note that his wife Elizabeth was of the daughters of Levi, of Aaron. She was a descendant of Aaron, the priest. And they were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord, blameless. Verse 7, and they had no child because that Elizabeth was barren, and they both were now well stricken in years, much as Abraham and Sarah were well stricken in years when they had their first child, Isaac. And it came to pass that while he executed the priest's office before God in the order of his course, that course being Abiah, and this is when he was on duty in Jerusalem, in other words, according to the custom of the priest's office, his lot was to burn incense when he went into the temple of the Lord, into the holy place. Only priests were allowed in there. And the whole multitude of the people were praying without at the time of incense. You see, the common thought among the people was that the incense, the smoke from the burning incense, ascended, and that their prayers would be taken with the incense smoke to our Heavenly Father. Verse 11, and there appeared unto him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. This is Gabriel, which means man of God, the archangel. And of course, Zacharias and Elizabeth, the parents of John the Baptist. And when Zacharias saw him, he was troubled, and fear fell upon him. You know, it would be rather startling to see an angel. Verse 13, but the angel said unto him, fear not, Zacharias, for thy prayer is heard. It wasn't just the prayers of those gathered outside that was going up with the incense. Zacharias's prayer was heard. And thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son, and thou shalt call his name John. John, if you translate, means Yahweh's gift, or Yahweh's favor. This John, of course, would become John the Baptist. And thou shalt have joy and gladness, and many shall rejoice at his birth. Why would many rejoice? Because he's the forerunner. He's the one who would announce the coming of Messiah. For he shall be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink. And he shall be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb. He will be under the vow of a Nazarite his entire life. And yes, the Spirit is in the womb. Remember Jeremiah chapter 1, the first 5 verses? God tells Jeremiah, I knew you when you were in your mother's womb. I placed your spirit. So if anyone ever questions when God places the Spirit, it's at conception. Verse 16, and many of the children of Israel shall he turn to the Lord their God. He came in the spirit of Elijah. I like to think that the spirit of Elijah is upon this ministry. We're turning the hearts of the children back to the Father with the capital F. And he shall go before him, before Christ, in other words, in the spirit and power of Elias, that's Elijah, to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. In the book of Isaiah, later chapters, he would say, make straight the way, the Lord comes. Verse 18. And Zacharias said unto the angel, whereby shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife well stricken in years. That's kind of ironic. Ahaz was offered a sign, and he refused the sign. Here we see Zacharias would like to have a sign. How am I going to know that this is really going to come to pass? I'm going to kind of tick Gabriel off. And the angel, this is Gabriel, answering, said unto him, I am Gabriel that stand in the presence of God, and am sent to speak unto thee and to show thee these glad tidings. But you don't believe me, he could have added. To Zechariah, the promise seemed too late. The promise that Gabriel will make to Mary will seem a little early. And behold, thou shalt be dumb, not able to speak, and not able to speak, the Bible says, until the day that these things shall be performed, because thou believest not my words. There he said it, you don't believe me, Zacharias, which shall be fulfilled in their season. 21, and the people waited for Zacharias and marveled that he tarried so long in the temple. What could be taking him so long? And when he came out, he could not speak unto them. And they perceived that he had seen a vision in the temple. For he beckoned unto them and remained speechless. This word beckoned in the Greek is dianuo. And it means to express with signs. Zacharias couldn't speak, so he was using sign language and probably writing notes to the people. And it came to pass that as soon as the days of his ministration were accomplished, in other words, his week of service in Jerusalem was up, he departed to his house. Now, there are two courses of Abia through the year. The first, June 13th through the 19th. Actually, I should say the first was December 22nd, December 6th through the 12th. And the reason it was the first was because they started counting when the Feast of Tabernacles was finished. So that would have been the first course, which would have been in September. So the first course following the beginning of the year was December 6th through the 12th, and the second course, June 13th through the 19th. So he left Jerusalem on June 20th. It would have taken him about 2 days to travel the 30 miles where he lived, which puts him home arriving on June 21st or 22nd, verse 24. I'll tell you how we know which course of Abias he was serving on in a moment. 24. And after those days, his wife Elizabeth conceived and hid herself 5 months, saying, all right, so June 21st or 22nd is when he got home. She conceived, and 5 months, we're now at November 24th. 25, thus hath the Lord dealt with me in the days wherein he looked on me to take away my reproach among men. And she was barren, and now her womb was opened up, and she was able to conceive. So she's a happy, happy girl. And in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto the city of Galilee named Nazareth, the sixth month of her pregnancy. So we are now at December 25th. And how do we know which course of Abia that Zacharias was serving? Well, it only makes sense. And those of you with companion Bibles, you have an appendix 179 that covers in detail what I'm telling you this morning. But had it been the other course of Abia when he got home, which would have been in December, that would have placed the birth of Christ. You see, John the Baptist was born March 28th through the 29th. He was 6 months older than Jesus. So if he had been born at the other course of Abia or conceived, that would have put the birth of Jesus in the dead of winter. December the 25th, number one, there was, what was the purpose of Mary and Joseph going to Jerusalem. There was a census. What's the purpose of the census? To raise taxes. So in the middle, the dead of winter, when it's snowing and it's cold, we're going to make the people come to Jerusalem for an unpopular census to increase their taxes. I don't think Caesar was even that stupid. Mary would have had to travel some 70 miles in the dead of winter. They say the shepherds were in the fields. There aren't any shepherds in the fields in December, people. There's no pasture. If they had their muttons out there, they'd been freezing their mittens off. It was cold. December 25th is the date we're at. Verse 27. To a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary, the house of Judah. And you see, Elizabeth is the cousin to Mary, we're going to learn. Their mothers were both of the house of Levi. More specifically, they were Aaronites, because we learned in chapter 3 of Luke that Mary's father was Heli of Judah. Verse 28, and the angel came in unto her and said, Hail, thou art highly favored. The Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed are we as well. And when she saw him, this being Gabriel, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind, deliberated in her mind, what manner of salutation this should be. What possible sort of salutation this was. I mean, here she is. She's not ever been with a man. And as I said a moment ago, to Zacharias, the promise was a little late. He was old. To Mary, the promise is a little early. She's never been with a man. Verse 30. And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. You know, every event that was a little bit out of the ordinary in God's word, most events, so let me say, that was a little bit out of the ordinary, God would send an angel to let the people know, okay, this is what's going to happen. Mary, you're going to have a child. And yeah, this might seem a little strange to you because you've never been with a man, but let me explain. And that's what's happening here. I can't help but believe that as the Antichrist, the approach of Antichrist comes, that the two witnesses and also, I believe, angels will visit God's elect to keep us on the right track. You know, it's much too important to God for his plan to come about just as it's written, to leave it to chance. He doesn't want anybody getting off track, losing focus. 31. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, December the 25th, and bring forth a son, and shalt call his name Jesus, Yeshua in the Hebrew, Yahweh's Savior. He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. Do you know the key of David? Revelation chapter 3, that key that opens doors that no man can shut and shuts doors that no man can open. And of course, that key is knowing that Jesus Christ is a descendant of David, who was the king of Judah. He wasn't the son of some descendant of the Kenites. Verse 33. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob. That's all 12 tribes forever. And of this his kingdom there shall be no end. A promise of 1 Samuel chapter 7 or 8 made to David that God would establish his throne forever was fulfilled. 34. Then said Mary unto the angel, How shall this be, seeing I know not a man? I haven't been with a man. How can I be with child? And the angel answered and said unto her, The Holy Spirit shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God, the only begotten Son. And behold, thy cousin Elizabeth, she hath also conceived a son in her old age, 6 months prior to this. And this is the sixth month with her, who was called barren. For with God nothing be impossible. Don't ever forget that verse. With God all things are possible. And Mary said, behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word. Let what you said come to pass. And the angel departed from her, message delivered. And Mary arose in those days and went into the hill country with haste into the city, into a city of Judah, going to share the good news with her cousin Elizabeth and her husband Zechariah, and entered into the house of Zacharias and saluted Elizabeth. And it came to pass that when Elizabeth heard the salutation of Mary, the babe, this being John, 6 months in Elizabeth's womb, leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. And she spake out with a loud voice and said, blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, and blessed are we all as well. And whence is this to me that the mother of my Lord should come to me? Who am I to get a visit from the mother of the Lord? For lo, as soon as the voice of thy salutation sounded in mine ears, the babe leaped in my womb for joy. Again, documenting that the Spirit is in that embryo. John felt the presence of the Holy Spirit in Christ and leapt in his mother's womb. The prophecy that we studied in Isaiah chapter 7 would come to pass. All of God's promises come to pass. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 1. Matthew chapter 1, we're going to pick it up with verse 18. Matthew 1:18. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise. This is how it came to pass. When as his mother Mary was espoused, this means engaged, promised, if you will, to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit at virgin conception. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man, he was a righteous man, and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privily. This means privately. And you know, that it was saving her reputation is what he was doing. He was concerned about Mary's reputation. I mean, here they're not married, and she's with child. How would that normally come to pass? But while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, Yeshua, Yahweh's Savior. For he shall save his people from their sins. The reason that he came to save us from our sins. Now all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet saying, and which prophet, of course, we know from our first scripture that we covered, Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. Then Joseph, being raised from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and took unto him his wife. This does not mean that he knew her in intercourse. He took her to wife. Verse 25, and knew her not till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus, the greatest gift of God to man to save us from our sins. Continuing on into chapter 2, verse 1. Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem. Were there three wise men, as tradition holds? Well, we'll kind of talk about that a little bit. But there was a salesman that was making sales calls down in Waco, Texas. And he went into this Quickie Mart to get a cup of coffee. And he asked the lady who was checking him out, he said, you know, I noticed your local town's nativity scene over by the courthouse. And what appeared to be three wise men were dressed up like firemen. One of them had a fireman's hat on, and they all had firemen's coats, and one of them had an oxygen tank on the back and a mask. He said, what's the deal with that? And she pulled out her Bible and opened it up and says, it says right there, the wise men came from afar. Oh, well. Don't quit your day job, they say, right? Chapter 2, verse 2. Saying, where is he that is born King of the Jews? These are the wise men. For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him. Now, the star, was it some myth that Christians made up over the years? Some Christian fictional tradition? No, God's word is true, and it always comes to pass. You see, this star was promised to us in the book of Numbers, Numbers chapter 24, verse 17, some 14 and a half centuries earlier, prophecy of that star. When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. Now, there were actually four different Herods. This particular one was called Herod the Great in some circles. And, you know, when he hears about another king, his ears started perking up. Herod was not interested in having any other king other than himself. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and the scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. The priests and scribes should know. It was written in the Old Testament. And they said unto him, in Bethlehem of Judea, it was written, for thus it is written by the prophet. Which prophet? Micah, chapter 5, verse 2, tells us the place of Messiah's birth. You see, what Herod's wanting to know is, when and where is he going to be born? How much time do I have to work with? Because I'm not going to have another king trying to take over my reign. I'm going to find him and kill him. Verse 6. And thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah. For out of thee shall come a governor, note the capital G, that shall rule my people Israel. Verse 7. Then Herod, when he had privily called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared. When did you see this star? When is he going to be born? How much time do I have to work with? And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and search diligently. Go spy for me, for the young child. And when you have found him, bring me word again that I may come and worship him also. You think that was Herod's intent to go and worship the Lord Jesus? No. His intent was to cunningly fool these people into telling him where he was so he could go kill him. Verse 9. When they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. Divine intervention. Was this some astronomical fluke? No, it was our Heavenly Father guiding these three wise men to the birthplace of Jesus Christ, Messiah, the promised. Verse 10. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. They knew they had found him. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. That's where the idea that there were three wise men come from the east, because there are three gifts. Verse 12, and being warned of God in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed into their own country another way. God takes care of his own. He's in control. And when they were departed, behold, the angel of the Lord appeareth to Joseph in a dream, saying, arise and take the young child and his mother, and flee into Egypt, and be thou there until I bring thee word, for Herod will seek the young child to destroy him. You know someone else who wanted that child destroyed? Satan. Why? Because that child would later, Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14, defeat death, defeat the one who has the power of death, that is to say, Satan. You see, if Messiah had not come and been crucified on the cross for our sins, Satan wins. Verse 14, when he arose, he, this being Joseph, took the young child, Jesus, and his mother by night and departed into Egypt, and was there until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, out of Egypt have I called my son. And which prophet? Hosea chapter 11, verse 1. Then Herod, when he saw that he was mocked of the wise men, was exceeding wroth, and sent forth and slew all the children that were in Bethlehem and all the coast or the borders thereof, from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had diligently inquired of the wise men. In verse 7, he's going to kill, he couldn't find Jesus, so I'll take care of it. I'll kill all the children that are 2 years old or younger. Then was fulfilled that which was spoken by Jeremy the prophet, saying, and when did Jeremiah say this? Jeremiah 31:15. In Ramah was there a voice heard, lamentation and weeping and great mourning, Rachel, the wife of Jacob, weeping for her children and would not be comforted because they are not, but they are. Satan cannot take God's children and seed line to Jesus away. God protected it. Verse 19. But when Herod was dead, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt. It's time to go home. Saying, arise and take the young child and his mother, and go into the land of Israel, for they are dead which sought the young child's life. Herod is dead. It's now safe for you to go home. Herod, it's historically recorded, died of a terrible, terrible illness, probably for killing all those 2 years old and younger in Bethlehem. And he arose and took the young child and his mother and came into the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus did reign in Judea in the room of his father Herod, he was afraid to go thither. Notwithstanding being warned of God in a dream, he turned aside into the parts of Galilee. Prophecy continuing to be fulfilled. Why in Galilee? And he came and dwelt in a city called Nazareth, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken of by the prophets. He shall be called a Nazarene, and a Nazarite he was. In conclusion, turn with me to Romans chapter 6. The greatest gift. Romans chapter 6. Let's pick it up with verse 14. The writings of Paul. For sin shall not have dominion over you. Don't let sin rule your life. For ye are now not under the law, but under grace. You know, those who died and lived before Christ was crucified were under the law. But we who were born after the crucifixion are under the dispensation of grace, forgiveness of God through Christ. Verse 15, Paul continues, what then, question, shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? God forbid. Does that give Christians the right to just sin all they want? Do whatever you want, anytime you want, and you're going to be forgiven? That's not the way it works. You see, when you become a Christian, you resurrect to a higher level. You instinctively know right from wrong. And you want to do what is right, not that which is wrong. So is Christianity a license to sin, is what Paul is saying? No, God forbid, it's not a license to sin. You're going to pay, just because you're a Christian, if you sin and you're not forgiven of them, you're going to pay for those sins. You're going to be judged by them. Verse 16, know ye not that to whom ye yield yourself servants to obey? Who are you going to obey? His servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. You can't serve both, but the choice is yours. You can do wicked or you can do righteously. But God be thanked that ye were the servants, note past tense, were the servants of sin. But ye have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine, Christianity, which was delivered you. In the Greek, this is better translated, whereto ye were delivered. Being then made free from sin, don't be a slave to sin. You become the servants of righteousness. If you serve sin, it becomes your master. I speak after the manner of men because of the infirmity or weakness of your flesh. The flesh is weak. For as you have yielded your members, servants to uncleanness and to iniquity, that's another word for sin, unto iniquity, even so now yield your members, servants to righteousness, unto holiness. You know, the flesh is weak. That's weak. That's the reason we should put our spiritual body, our spiritual inner man, in charge of our flesh. The flesh is weak. For when you were the servants of sin, again, past tense, you were free from righteousness. In other words, there wasn't any righteousness in you. There wasn't a righteous bone in your body. What fruit had ye then in those things whereof ye are now ashamed? Question. For the end of those things is death. But now, being made free from sin and become servants to God, ye have your fruit unto holiness and the end everlasting life. 23 to conclude. For the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God, the greatest gift, is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. So as we enter this holiday season, you know, it's good for the kids to get excited about what's under the tree, and that's all great. But don't ever forget the greatest gift of all, and which is, of course, God's gift, his only begotten Son, that he sacrificed on the cross for our sins. Let's go to his throne. Yahweh, Heavenly Father, we do thank you, Father, for that sacrifice that you made for our sins, Father. We come to you this morning repentant as a group, Father, and we thank you for blotting out our sins, Father, that we come to you with a repentant heart, Father. Let us go into this holiday season with a clean slate with you, Father. And we thank you for your Son. We thank you for the love that you showed in this greatest gift of all. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
The Mark of the Beast on CD is our free introductory offer to you. What is the Mark of the Beast? Many false teachers would have you believe it will be a tattoo on your forehead or a computer chip implanted under your skin. It's getting late in the game. You need to know what the Mark of the Beast is. As it's written in Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, many will be deceived. Christ said in Mark 13, 23, "Behold, I have foretold you all things."
And you'll learn that there are 24 courses of the priest. And the way that worked is that the priests were on duty in Jerusalem from Sabbath to Sabbath, 1 week. And then the next course rotated in. And when you say, well, there are 24 courses, there are 52 weeks in the year. How did that work out? Well, you see, they rotated through the 24 courses, and then they rotated again through the 24 courses. And then you had the major ingatherings, Passover, the Feast of Weeks, and also the Feast of Tabernacles. And there were such a great number of sacrifices made on those periods of time that all the priests were on duty in Jerusalem at that time. Judy in Pennsylvania, being that a thief is a sneak and a crook, what would be the purpose of Jesus using the terminology of returning like a thief in the night? And Judy's referring to Matthew chapter 24, verse 43. And the point that Jesus is making there is that no one knows when he's going to return, the second advent. And what he's saying is that if the good man of the house had known when the thief was coming to rob him, he would have stayed home and prevented the robbery. But Jesus, again, the point that he's making there is no one knows the hour that he will return. He told us himself that only his Father, that's our Heavenly Father, knows when the Lord will return, the second advent. Paul from Maryland. I've been studying with the Shepherd's Chapel for a little over 3 years, and I'm addicted to the Word of God. That's a good thing to be addicted to. And hopefully be blessed like Pastor Arnold and yourself. Well, thank you for that. The question that I have for you is that, is baptism by proxy practiced in your church? 1 Corinthians 15:29 speaks of the dead being baptized, and I have gone over it 3 times with Pastor Arnold. He did not imply this practice was acceptable by the church other than, quote, it was okay to pray for the dead and nothing about someone else being baptized by proxy for the dead. This question is very important to me because someone has suggested this practice, which I am against. Is there a Bible reference to this subject matter? If so, where? Please explain. Excuse me, and thank you both for your wonderful teaching of the Word, and you're welcome. Baptism by proxy is not biblical, and certainly not taught nor practiced by the Shepherd's Chapel. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 29 isn't talking about the dead being baptized. That's probably one of the most mistaught and misunderstood verses in the Bible. What Paul is saying in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 29 is that if the dead rise not at all. In other words, if Jesus didn't resurrect from the dead, then why on earth would you baptize in a dead man's name? In other words, why would you baptize in the name of Jesus Christ if Jesus didn't resurrect? Because he's a dead man. He wasn't resurrected, in other words. That's not talking about baptizing for the dead. You know, once we all stand before God, before the great white throne judgment of Revelation chapter 20, and there's no one standing between us and the Heavenly Father on the great white throne. No one can be baptized for you in the flesh, or after you have died, no one can take your sins except one, and that, of course, was Jesus Christ. I encourage you to wash your sins in his blood. Mary in Georgia, we have a question concerning the two witnesses. Will they still have the name Moses and Elijah when they return? As the time is getting closer, that is what we are watching for to happen very soon with what all is going on in the world nowadays. And yes, things are clicking, and it'll all happen on God's schedule, of course. I believe Moses and Elijah will be the two witnesses. Logic behind that, well, who appeared with Christ in transfigured bodies in Matthew chapter 17 on the Mount of Transfiguration? Moses and Elijah. Will they have the same names, Moses and Elijah? I don't know the answer. That's not written. It's not biblical. Regardless of their name, though, God's election will know who the two witnesses are. Why? Because they're the two candlesticks. They're going to be pumping oil, that's truth, symbolic of truth, to the 7,000, God's elect. Kevin in Arkansas, is it okay to use credit cards with a computer chip in them? Is this a bad thing? Nothing wrong with using credit cards with a chip. Just don't get caught up in usury and run up a big bill on a credit card and then pay 20 to 30% interest. That's a danger of a credit card with a chip. And I think you're thinking that the chip in the credit card might be the mark of the beast. I assure you, the chip in the credit card is not the mark of the beast. If you don't know what the mark of the beast is, you need to order our free introductory offer. And when I say free, I mean it's absolutely free. The telephone number for you to call is free. The CD is free. And we don't even ask for you to pay for the postage. We'll pick up the tab on that. It's completely free. You need to know what the mark of the beast is. Peggy in Oklahoma. I know that after the judgment, God will wipe away our tears. Who will wipe his tears away? Can you give me scripture on this subject? You know, that's compassionate of you, Peggy. You know, not many people would be worried about wiping God's tears away. And you know, I thought at first, God doesn't have tears. And I'll bet he does have tears. When he looks down sometimes at what's going on the earth, he has emotions just like we do. How do I know that? Because we were created in he and the angels' image. Genesis chapter 1 tells us that. So I'm sure God has tears, and again, that's very compassionate of you to think about that. It is written in Revelation 21:4 that when God comes back to earth for the eternity, this is where heaven is going to be, right here on earth. He's going to rejuvenate the earth. It's written there that he will wipe away the tears of his children. And maybe he'll let you wipe away his tears. I don't know. We'll see. CG in Texas. When will this earth end, and will there be another world when this earth ends? And you know, that's a question that I'm glad you asked, CG. You see, a lot of people when they hear us teaching here at the chapel about the first, second, and third earth and heaven ages, they think that the world, that they think that we're teaching that the world is going to end. The world is not going to end. God's home is going to be here in the eternity. And you got to think of it as ages, not different worlds, different periods of time. When the first earth and heaven age ended, the second earth and heaven age began. When the second earth and heaven age ends, the third heaven and earth, the eternity ages, will begin. Angela in Pennsylvania, I have lots of questions, but I want to begin with Genesis chapter 3, verse 6. Please explain the tree to be desired. What is it? And please explain Genesis chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. All right, the tree to be desired is the same that was in chapter 2, chapter 3, where God instructed Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, you can partake of any of the trees in the garden, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. That was the serpent. Eve partook of that tree. She conceived. Chapter 4, she gave birth to Cain. She also gave birth to Abel. Cain was Satan, the serpent's son. Abel was Adam's son. They were twins. And you know the rest. Cain murdered Abel. I'm out of time. I love you all a great deal because you enjoy studying God's Word. I want to wish you all a happy Thanksgiving. If you're watching the live program, the next two programs will be specials, and then we'll be back in the Book of Kings immediately following that. We are brought to you by your tithes and offerings. If we've helped you, help us keep coming to you and to reach out to others who are lost in this world of darkness. Most important this, though, you stay in His Word every day, and your Father's Word is a good day, even with trouble. You know why? Because Jesus is the living Word.
Hearing God's Word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's Word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast CD, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a CD catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645, 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at the same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you. The Mark of the Beast on CD is our free introductory offer to you. What is the Mark of the Beast? Many false teachers would have you believe it will be a tattoo on your forehead or a computer chip implanted under your skin. It's getting late in the game. You need to know what the Mark of the Beast is. As it's written in Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, many will be deceived. Christ said in Mark 13, 23, "Behold, I have foretold you all things." Jesus indeed told us how not to be deceived, and Pastor Arnold Murray takes you on a step-by-step study of God's Word concerning this critical subject. The telephone call is free, the CD is free, no shipping and handling. Just call 800-643-4645 to request your one-time, one-per-household copy of The Mark of the Beast. You may also mail your request to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Don't be deceived by Satan.
From Gravette, Arkansas, this is Shepherd's Chapel with Pastor Arnold Murray. Join with us now as Pastor Murray takes you on a book by book, chapter by chapter, line by line, study in God's Word. Now, here's Pastor Murray.
All right, good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Hey, welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. You know what we're going to talk about today? You got it there, seed planting. I want to do this basically for the lay person that really wants to share perhaps some newly gained knowledge from God's Word. The subject being seed planting is how do you go about it? And you never...